you're under the spell, under the power of love.
It's a power of love,
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 the power of love.
So you're sitting in a restaurant and you feel so nonchalant. When the waiter says, what'll it be? You start to speak, then suddenly a pretty girl walks across the floor. You ain't thinking about food. No more.
Power of love, like a tidal wave. It can pick you up and knock you on the floor. It can do the things you've never done before.
Ah, 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 ah.
Don't imagine that you're free. There's no escaping from reality. You're under the spell, under the power of love.
as the sharks were coming for me, I felt Mandy pull me up, give me the kiss of life, just like the girl in Dr. No.
Yeah. walking down the street, concentrating on trucking right. I heard a dark voice beside of me, and I looked round in a state of fright. I saw four faces, one man, a brother from the gutter. They looked me up and down a bit and turned to each other.
Respect. Don't you walk through my words, 'cause you ain't heard me out yet.
When he looked down at my silver chain, he said, I'll give you $1. I said, you've got to be joking, man. Was a present from me, mother. He said, I like it, I want it, I'll take it off your hands and you'll be sorry. You cross me, you better understand that you're alone. Something harder. She said, I've got it, you want it. My harvest is the best, and if you try it, you'd like it. And wallow in it. Dreadlock Holiday.
Thank you.
So don't forget it. It's just a silly phase I'm going through. Just because I call you up. Don't get me wrong, don't think you got it made. I'm not in love, no, no. It's because
thank you.
street without your shoes on. You didn't listen what your mama said. She said you won't feel a benefit,
won't feel a benefit.
And if we all went out without our shoes on, tell me where would we be? Where would we be? Oh. All the people in the world lost their justify themselves.
Won't feel the benefit.
You're like a cloud behind the sun, like the face behind the cloud. You're moving like the wrinkles in a frown, and you can never look back. The leaf that's born upon the wind, cardboard suitcase in your hand, the wanderer soon returns and finds the color of the grass is just the same. Thank you.
the street and take your chances. But if you do, you better do it right, or you won't feel the benefit.
Won't feel the benefit.
Spin the wheel and take your chances, and your number might come up, though the odds may be. Say it together.
You said you'd find a cheap motel.
I love it. I think it's a veritable suite.
Well, at least they didn't ask about our luggage.
Yeah, they didn't ask about our marriage license either. Look, I never promised you a rose garden. I promised you a couple of hamburgers, some French fries, a little cheap red wine to celebrate.
What are we celebrating?
We are celebrating being alive and being together.
There's only one bed.
How many do you want?
I'm not sleeping in the same bed with you.
Who asked you to?
You know, you shouldn't have wasted money on this wine. I don't have that much.
Laura, don't ever accuse me of running off with you for your money.
Can I help at how much money I have?
You know, you'll never measure up to Jennifer. You have no house, you have no money, you have no sailboat. I gotta be out of my mind.
First thing you said that makes any sense at all.
Eat your hamburger.
There's no ketchup for the French fries.
Dip them in the wine.
How's your head?
Oh, thanks for asking. I forgot about it. I guess I don't have a concussion.
So where are you gonna sleep?
Will you please get your mind off sex?
Luke!
Look, I didn't ask for this honeymoon. I didn't plan this honeymoon. This is the way it turned out. So let's just make the best of it. Either that or you go back to Prince Charming.
He called me a tramp. And he accused me of sleeping with you.
Trying to find the courage, but I let you walk away. And I can't forget your face, you know it haunts me all the time. And it seems to me I'm living in a dream. Wish we could run away. We could be alone together.
Don't want to live without.
If I'm backward, coming forward, would you help me realize all the answers to the questions I've been asking with my eyes? I could hand you all the cliches, but you've heard them all before. And I want to say I love you in my own way. And could we run away? We could be alone together, far away, leave the world behind. What I want to say is, you're a part of me. Let me be a part of you. Run away. We could be alone together, far away, leave the world behind. Run away. What I you're a part of me. Let me be a part of
trucking right. I heard a dark voice beside of me, and I looked round in a state of fright. I saw four faces, one man, a brother from the gutter. They looked me up and down a bit and turned to each other.
Would you like something harder? She it, I got it. You want it, my harvest is the best. And if you try it, you'll like it. I'm wallowing a dreadlock holiday.
I'm sorry, what did you say?
I said you look like you've just seen a ghost. It wouldn't surprise me. Geraldine said there are ghosts all over this house.
No, I wouldn't be surprised a bit. Where have you been, love?
I went out for a drink with a girlfriend.
Why didn't you invite Geraldine? I was told that she had been here.
Oh, yeah. I asked her if she wanted to come, but she said that she didn't want to.
Do you have a good visit?
What?
With your friend.
Oh, yeah. We had a lot to talk about. We haven't seen each other in years.
So you had quite a bit to catch up on.
Yeah.
And things like your favorite fudge recipe and the latest embroidery stitches, things like that?
No. We talked about the men in our lives.
Is that what took you so long?
Yeah. But it was nice. I haven't talked to her for a long time.
And who's the man in her life?
Her husband. Just like my husband is the man in my life.
And what did you tell her about the man in your life?
I told her all about you. I told her about the wedding, and I told her about the honeymoon, and about how wonderful you are.
I don't know if I like the idea of you talking about me to other people. I don't know if I like the idea of other people knowing my business.
You didn't talk about your business. I told her how wonderful and generous and attractive you are.
Don't change your heart. on the ground.
Come on and feed my senses. Oh. It was like a scientific lab, really, 10cc, where we were encouraging each other to push the limits of what a pop song could be. Load
up, load up. We were a completely self-contained band. We just did what we wanted to do. We were not in the slightest bit interested in anybody else.
I believe that, musically at least, we achieved a lot in a very short space of time.
10cc was definitely on its own planet. We would experiment on every song we ever took in the studio. And I think we did open up some avenues that people had never thought of trying.
When you look back at 10cc now, and if you look through their whole careers, not just while they were part of the group, I mean, you realize that it was an amazing meeting of so much talent.
They have influence beyond the obvious influence of nice songs and hit records. And more than almost any other group, they have branched out into lots of different areas, particularly electronics, videos, great songwriting. I mean, they're much more than just an ordinary pop group.
Manchester scene was amazing because there were so many clubs, so many venues for bands to play in. And every Saturday I go out with my mates and we'd just go and see bands. We'd just go from club to club.
We saw at these clubs before they had hit, the Stones and all those Liverpool bands. So there was a very lively, healthy music, sweaty club scene.
A bit of publicity and a bit of action was coming out of Manchester, sort of early 60s. Most of the kids of that period wanted to be in a band. I don't know why, but they did. Everyone wanted to be in a band, and it was just a real hoot.
One of the first groups I was with was called the Empress of Rhythm, and we went to an audition at the BBC, and on stage walked these four guys who had leather jackets and jeans on. It was the Beatles. And I sat there looking at these four guys saying, these guys are incredible, they're so different. And I talked about it to my mates in the Empress of Rhythm, and they were all saying, no way, man, no way. Cliff and the Shadows are the best. Cliff and the Shadows, yeah. These guys are never going to make it. They failed the audition. The Beatles failed the BBC audition. We passed with all our Shadows footsteps.
When I was 14 and underage and going to these clubs, I saw Eric Stewart in the Empress of Rhythm, and he later went on to join Wayne Fontana and the Mindbenders and became a pop star, you know, before we even met.
The first record we released went to number 46, and because we were now a chart group, I was suddenly earning more than my father was in one night than he would earn in a week. And then Game of Love was number one in Britain, number one in America in 1965. I would have been 19 then. But after that, Wayne wanted to go solo. And he walked out on us one night on stage. He just suddenly turned around and said, it's all yours, guys, and disappeared off stage. So we just carried on and we went down the storm. Went back to the studio to see the A&R man again and said, Wayne's left the band. He said, well, it's funny, Eric. He said, I've got a song here that I think would suit your voice. It's called Groovy Kind of Love. We recorded it. It was number one everywhere.
I was first aware of Eric Stewart as a mind bender, and it was one of those interesting phenomena where the backing band does better than the lead singer after the lead singer and the band split. And the Mindbenders had this massive hit in America, and I think it got to number two in England, Groovy Kind of Love, which was just a great song.
Wouldn't you agree, baby, you and me?
It's amazing to think that Eric was in the Mindbenders. I don't think people register this at all, because of course they associate the group with Wayne Fontana. But I mean, it's important to see that these people were just all bees in this big hive that was the Northern scene in the 60s in this country, and such an important, vibrant part of what was called the British invasion in America.
I started writing seriously when I was about 18. I was in a band with Kevin called the Mockingbirds. I was so inspired and turned on by the Beatles that I thought, I'm going to really do some serious songwriting. And I came up with a couple of songs that were recorded, one of which was For Your Love. And our record company turned our version of it down, and it eventually found its way to the Yardbirds, and that became my first hit as a songwriter. When I think back of what I wrote before For Your Love, it was pretty crass, I think. But For Your Love was different, and I sort of entered a different era of my songwriting, particularly like 65, 66 were very, very productive for me as a songwriter. I mean, every era is productive, but I mean productive in the very successful songs.
People don't appreciate the depth of the catalogue that Graham Gouldman assembled, the world hits that he churned out. For the Yardbirds, both For Your Love and Heartful of Soul were American top 10 records. And then Herman's Hermits, a million seller with Listen People, number three in America, and No Milk Today, which was the flip of There's a Kind of Hush.
No milk today, it seems a common sight.
And then, of course, the Hollies, Bus Stop, which was their first American top 10 record and is in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame.
When we first met Graham Gouldman, he looked like he was 12, but he must have been like 15 or something. He sat down, he picked up the guitar, and he goes, Bus stop, wet day, she's there, I say, please. Now, from the opening line, if you're smart at all, you know that this is a great song. And not only is it a great song, but it could be a single, it could be a hit, a smash.
All that summer we enjoyed it, wind and rain and shine.
So he gets to the end of the song and we go, great, what else have we got, right? He goes, well, I got this song that I wrote about a week ago. It goes like this. Look through any window, yeah.
What do you see?
And so we wanted that song too, because we knew what the Hollies could do to that song.
Look through any window, yeah. What do you see?
There's no doubt about it that we recognized in Graham Coleman that he was really a formidable writer. And that little kid that we met changed my life for the better. You know, because Busto was a smash for the Hollies. Look Through Any Window was a smash for the Hollies. And that set us off on a trajectory that I've been on ever since, you know. So in a very profound way, Graham Coleman changed my life, no doubt about it. He's a good kid, we knew that the moment we met him.
I do remember one or two articles about Graham Coleman in the very early days saying, you know, he's written four or five mega hits for other acts, but he can't seem to write one for his own band, which was the Mockingbirds. And they were a good group, but for some reason, the other group seemed to nab the really commercial songs. But he had enormous variety in his songwriting way before he began displaying that in 10cc.
Graham was a top-rate writer. He may not have realized it at the time because he was so young and he was just doing it as his job. But the fact is, he has one of the best catalogs in this country, and he should be recognized for that.
I always wanted to manage Graham because I thought Graham was brilliant. I used to stick around and meet him and try and encourage him. I knew Kevin Loll as well. We were from a tight community. We all lived near each other. Kevin Loll were crazies. I loved Kevin Loll. They were inseparable. They were like students. They always had mad ideas.
Kevin and I had become such close chums doing crazy projects together, art projects and music projects. And through Graham, we met Eric and really liked Eric. And that was the first time we started a relationship with Eric Stewart.
Eric was a bit of a star in his own right. But I think more than anything else, he wanted to be a producer, an engineer, and very smartly he sort of partnered with a guy in the local music shop, and they laboriously set up what became Strawberry Studios.
We'd found this old building in the middle of Stockport and started to turn it into a studio. We're doing it ourselves with hammers and nails. It's incredible. And we started with a very little control desk and two stereo machines, and Strawberry Studios opened and we started getting work. So I went from the Mindbenders to being an engineer at Strawberry.
For some reason, he got in touch with myself and Lowell to come and help him test the first version of the studio. And we just tried some stuff, really, to test the capabilities of the new equipment.
You needed somebody that would bang drums endlessly for hours on end while he fiddled and, you know, finessed the noise to get a good drum sound. Even Kevin was beginning to fade. So I went in and I sat on the floor with an acoustic guitar, and I sat in front of the bass drum and I started strumming any old stuff just to keep Kevin buoyant, really, so they could keep banging. And Eric was very enthusiastic, said, just a bit more. and at some point, to keep me occupied, I started singing this nursery rhyme that sort of came spontaneously.
It was simply a test, but a guy, a music publisher, swung by and heard what we were doing and said, it's a smash. People actually did say things like that in those days. And we promptly wiped it by mistake, erased it, and I had to start again from scratch.
Got it slightly better because we knew what we were doing a bit, and indeed that's how Neanderthal Man was made, and it was released and it was a hit everywhere.
The studio was getting more professional after Neanderthal Man was a hit. We were being booked all the time, and Graham Gouldman had been working in America. When he heard that we were actually working together with people, he joined our backing group team.
Essentially, we were four disparate guys who became a house band for the various acts that came through the door of Strawberry Studios. And it was, I don't know, it was more like Broadway Danny Rose than rock and roll. There were some pretty bizarre people came through that door. We found ourselves doing music for football teams and TV producers' girlfriends, ventriloquists, and God knows what else. So it was a crash course in being versatile.
I remember Harvey Lisberg, Graham's manager, persuaded Neil Sedaka, who had had his hits in the 50s and had a pretty dry run in the 60s, he was pretty much out of favour. He sold Neil on these great guys at Strawberry Studios in Manchester that could produce wonderful material for him.
Neil was actually due to make a new record and had all this material. And I think the idea was he'd come over and do like two or three songs. But it worked like magic, and we all got on very well, and Neil did the whole album.
That's when the music takes me.
We did five hit singles, I think, and a couple of hit albums. He came back again. And it was Neil said, you should keep working on your own material because you deserve to have some hits. You're good. And he encouraged us.
I've no idea why we never thought of it before, but we didn't. And it was only after we'd finished the album with Neil Sedaka that we decided that we should become a band. Eric and I had written a song called Waterfall that Apple Records, the Beatles record company, were interested in putting out. So we thought, well, in case they do, let's get everything ready. And because Eric and I had written the A side, we thought it was fair that Kevin and Lars would write the B side.
So we went next door to the control room and knocked out Donna. We came and recorded it, and everyone, when we'd finished that, we thought, well, maybe this is even more commercial than Waterfall.
Donna was a sort of pastiche of 50s doo-wop, and Eric had the bright idea of asking Jonathan King to come down and have a listen to it, which he subsequently did and again said, it's a smash. People still said those kind of things.
I said, are you serious? He said, yeah, it's a smash. What's the name of the band? I said, we haven't got a name. So he said, well, this is really weird, Eric. Last night I had a dream and I saw a poster. It said, 10cc, the greatest group in the world. I said, okay, sounds great to me, the greatest group in the world. I'll ask the guys. And they said, yeah, okay, is he offering us a deal? I said, yeah. He offered us a deal and we signed up with him. And he released that record, Donna, a number two, from nowhere.
After Donna, we put out another single called Johnny Don't Do It that completely bombed. It was in a similar vein to Donna. It was another pastiche. And maybe we would, enough with the pastiche already. You did it. You did it once.
So we cleared the slate to start again. And the next thing we wrote was Rubber Bullets. And that just seemed to have a life of its own when we recorded it and finished it. And it was an even bigger hit. Donna went to number two and Rubber Bullets actually went to number one. It was our first number one.
Rubber Bullets I always loved. I think it's just a hilarious song and really smart and really clever and yeah, something joyful about it. Load up, you know, it's that kind of brilliant, super poppy, with this nuts idea for a song. You know, like it's a crazy idea, lyrically. Roll up, rubber bullets. It's like, what are you on about? It's mad, but brilliant. You know, why would you do that in a pop song? But they did, and they got away with it.
There's a rumor going around that road that a fuse is gonna blow at the local hop, at the local county jail.
What you gonna do, mommy, what you gonna do?
The actual amazing directions that we were taking musically came mostly from Godley and Cream. he would just come up with the most ridiculous idea. But eventually, you would not say, we can't do that, that's ridiculous. You would say, let's try it.
It was a very sort of energized atmosphere in the studio because we had these sort of basically two writing teams. And Eric and I would be in one room, Kevin and Ollie would be in another room. And like whoever finished the song first would go, we got one. And we'd listen to it and we'd play it to the other boys and they'd come up with suggestions and changes.
It certainly was a chemical reaction and we were lucky. But I think part of the reason it worked out so well is because we positioned ourselves so that no one could interfere. We were out of the limelight, we were away from London, we were a little studio in Stockport, of all places. And probably no one even knew we were there, so we could just mess around and play and experiment.
But in the eyes of the dean, his daughter was doing what she should have ordered. But a man's gotta do what a man's gotta do. The consequence should be...
I remember listening to the Dean and I when Kevin and Lol played it for us. It was just such an amazing song. I could almost say if anything represented 10cc, it was that song. It had everything. I mean, there are so many musical changes in it. The chords are amazing. I've never heard anything like it since.
I hated that song. I hated the Dean and I. Because I really wasn't very, very fond of American musicals. I always thought it was a bit cheesy, you know. What have we got? We ain't got dames, oh, and all that stuff. And I thought, all right, I'm going to go along and record this because, you know, we're a very democratic group. I thought, but how can I do something different in this? So I put some blues guitar in it, and it fattened it up, and it put some balls into it.
It's so anti his influences, which are sort of rock and roll and blues. And this came from Doris Day and South Pacific and Rodgers and Hammerstein and that whole genre, so it was a world away. And we didn't see any barriers, we didn't see any reason why we shouldn't.
We wrote those songs because we wrote that. I don't know why we wrote songs like that, but what we were into was harmony. We liked singing, we liked testing our, and we had the facility, we had the time to try and get harmonies right. We didn't have anybody breathing down our necks. We sort of gravitated towards that kind of stuff, just naturally.
We just did stuff. There was very little thought. It was about doing as opposed to thinking. And the first album, I think, was written and recorded in 3 weeks, which sounds crazy these days, because people labor and craft and hone and carve, smooth and polish. We didn't, we just did it. And it was all the better for it, because what came out was pure us.
It's a wonderful world when you're all in a color.
The writing of the songs was very important to us all in those days, and it became the form that when you had a separate kind of colour in the writing, it was worth trying a different vocal colour. By that, I mean either of harmony or a different lead voice or any combination that we could figure out.
We used to have a system of, because we'd all like to try out for the vocals, mostly, but to save time, you know, we'd go into the studio and someone would sing on this particular song, then we'd have a sign that just said, next.
You would hang your head in shame and go back into the control room and the next person would go in and have a go at singing the song. And that's the audition process for 10cc's vocal lead vocals.
Eric and I tended to write more, I think it was kind of a sort of pop influence, whereas Kevin and Lyle were more into experimenting, but then they needed, I think, more of our studying influence on them. Sometimes the songs would benefit from our rearranging them. They would do one brilliant part and never ever repeat it. It would drive me mad. So you've got to repeat this at somewhere else. Hey, maybe you could do it like this.
It's something that you get a certain extent with the Beatles as well. You get those different voices and those different ideas coming through. But with 10cc, it was that kind of slightly cut and pasty feel to their albums and even to their songs. It's in many ways quite ahead of its time. You get that quite a lot in modern pop songs nowadays. You're just noticing like shifts of mood really quickly. And there are certain modern songwriters who've taken a lot from that.
It's quite obvious that there are the two main inputs, the traditional songwriting as represented by Graham and Eric, and then the art school background as represented by Lowell and Kev. And when you bring more than one source of material to a group, you make the group richer. And so 10cc had a wider and deeper catalog than they would have had they been just one or the other. You bounce out, you read the deal, but you're living on it.
You got a temper, you follow it, and you make a big killing. To me, if there was one album that epitomizes 10cc, it's Sheet Music. We've got lots of very, very good reviews for that album. And I think, rightly so, he said modestly.
After Sheet Music, which was a big seller, we had hits, big hits. Worldwide, we were getting bigger sales. We were stone broke. 10cc were skint, because our contract was paying us 4%. I called Jonathan King. I said, Jonathan, we've been with you 3 years now. We've got 2 years to run on our contract. 4%, I'm sorry, we can't survive on it. We're skint.
He had this kind of public school attitude. You signed the contract. We're going to the letter of the contract. We're not changing it. You signed it. He was just rigid. So the boys sort of said, we've got to get away, we've got to get another label.
It became a bit of a meat market, really. Bids were coming in from every record company for 10cc, because it was decided we were changing the label. And it was only a matter of who we went with, and every single label was after us. In our minds, it was a done deal, because we'd met Richard Branson, and he wanted us to be on Virgin. That was very exciting, but even more exciting was the fact that he proposed to release us in America through Atlantic, and we were thrilled about that, because that was the best label out for America, and we hadn't cracked America yet.
Unfortunately, we weren't all there at the same time to sign the contract, so Lol and I left power of attorney with our management to sign with Richard Branson's Virgin Records.
The idea was that we'd all go, the boys in the band would all go on their holidays the next morning, and Kevin, Eric and I, with our wives who were sisters, were going off to St. Lucia in the West Indies for a really well-earned holiday, because we were absolutely knackered.
Got off the plane in St. Lucia, and as I'm walking from the plane, a man comes up to me. He said, Mr. Stewart, Mr. Eric Stewart? I said, yes, that's me. He said, I've got a telephone call for you. Picked the phone up. I said, hi, this is Eric. A voice on the other end says, this is Richard from Virgin Records. Your management have signed you with Philips Phonogram. I said, what? I'm sorry. I don't know anything about this. Can I get back to you? He said, you better do that, and slammed the phone down.
And the reason for that was that after we'd all, the boys had left the office, yet another phone call had come in from Polyglot and made another offer, added an extra, you know, whatever it was to the sum of money. And the managers, with their power of attorney, had said, yes, we'll take that. And I can only speak for myself. I was absolutely horrified, embarrassed, and disgusted. And to this day, I still am.
There was a lot of money involved in this deal, a lot of money. And it was the security and the future of the band financially that depended on this deal. And with hindsight, of course, we're all geniuses, and probably it would have been right to go with Virgin now, having looked back. At that time, you had the choice between either you're going to secure your future or you're going to have a gamble. And a gamble two ways. A, you don't even know the record's going to sell, because the record company like Virgin had one hit, Tubular Bells. That was it. They were nothing. I mean, now, yeah, that huge cooperation and everything has gone smoothing. Well, if I could see the future, you know, I wouldn't need to manage a band, really, would I?
I was driving home when I thought I heard somebody on the radio say, life is a minestrone. I don't think they had said that, but it sounded like that. And I thought, well, there's a philosophy. I'm leaning on the Tower of Pisa. And if life is a minestrone, to me, I hate cold food. I can't eat cold food. So death is a cold lasagna to me. And Eric and I had our turn at writing together. We came up with that bit of nonsense, you know. And that was the first track, because the record company wanted to go with something safe with this new album, this new act that they had. And it seemed like a more obviously commercial song, minestrone.
I think by the time we got into original soundtrack, we'd shown that our way of doing things could be successful. So we were left alone to crack on with things. And we were trying a bit harder to push our boundaries in different ways.
There was always still this desire to go one better with a song and do something different with it. Hence, I'm Not in Love. The way that song developed, which, looking back on it, it was astounding. We ever released it, we ever got it out, we ever got it finished.
The title was Eric's. We've been discussing writing a love song, but I don't think we wanted to write a cliche. And I'm Not in Love was the perfect title.
I wrote all the words, completely. And I took it into the studio. And Graham Gulman said, yeah, I'll finish it with you. I think there's a great idea there. So we sat down, we completed it. Graham put some lovely chords into it. And we went in the studio to record it as a bossa nova. Congos and things and bongos.
When we heard it back, everyone was underwhelmed, I think is the best word, and it was, nobody had the real enthusiasm to carry on with it. It sounded so underwhelming.
Yeah, I hated it. Oh, sure, I'll say I didn't like it particularly. I didn't get it particularly. There was something in there, and we all recognised that there was something in there, but that treatment didn't really bring it to life. And we weren't really sure what we could do with it. I think I said at the time, well, why don't we do it with voices, no instruments, just all a tsunami of voices, wash of voices. Probably out of desperation, really, trying to come up with something to make this thing come to life.
And I said, what do you mean, a cappella? You know, we all sing without a backing. He said, no, the backing track. Let's do the whole backing track with voices, like a massive choir, the biggest choir you can imagine. I said, great, how do we do it? How do we do that? There's only four of us. And Lol said, tape loops. I said, great. All right, let's do it. And we spent 3 weeks recording three of them in the studio, Kevin, Lol and Graham, singing, ah, as long as they could hold their breath. Then they did that 16 times on the 16-track machine, copied all that across to a stereo machine, and we had 13 notes to choose from, a chromatic scale with a top C and a bottom C. And 624 voices were there at our disposal. I then played them back through the 16-track machine, through the control desk, and I gave each of us a set of three faders to go up and down when the chords were changing for I'm Not in Love, and the little
all of us worked the desk and played it like a keyboard. And when we had all the notes playing together, you got that lovely abstract ah, because it's a mass of harmonics all bleeding together. So we kept them, all of the notes, in to a certain degree with a piece of masking tape so that the faders were all at a certain level. And that's what made that in-tune harmonic sound, but with an extra something. And it made something really special.
Originally, I think we were going to do it with just voices, nothing else. So we recorded a rhythm track, which we thought was going to be a temporary. And I think the idea was that we'd sing to that and do all the vocals, then we'd take that off and we'd be left with this song recorded with just the choir and the vocals. But there was something about it, there was magic about it. And of course, once we put the other voices on, we didn't want to touch anything, we didn't want to take it out.
I'm not in love, so don't forget it. It's just a silly phase I'm going through.
I did the lead vocal again, but the guy vocal I'd done was so good, we kept it. So it was basically finished. And then you come to the Godley and Cream moment again. What should we do next? Just as we said that, the secretary at the studio, Kathy Redfern, popped her head round the door. She said, "Eric, there's a phone call for you."
And then they said, "That's it." So I immediately turned round and ran back to the reception area. I thought, no way. And Lowell came after me, actually, and took me in, and said, "We want you to do something for us." All the time I'm thinking, no, I can't sing, I can't do this. And I remember Kev came in with me into the studio and they said, "You've just got to whisper. Be quiet, big boys don't cry."
Are you crazy? Are you out of your mind? This doesn't make any sense.
I hate you!
Alex!
I hate you!
Alex!
I hate you! And if you were such a great mother, how come your kids dropped out of school and ran away, huh?
Alex!
Oh, hey!
In those days, we tried everything. If someone had an idea, it got tried. It didn't always work, but I think this was one of those sessions where whatever you added to it after a certain point, it just kept on getting better. You know, astonishing.
Are you sure you want to suffer the tortures of a memory of a lost love? Do you know the tortures of the memory of a lost love? It's awful! It will haunt you night and day. You'll wake up at night screaming. You can't eat. You can't sleep. You'll want to smash things. You'll hate yourself and the world and everybody in it. Oh! Are you sure you want to risk losing me?
If you have to prove your manhood, get somebody your own age.
Shut up!
Oh, what's the matter with you? What's the matter with you, doctor? Ever try getting your kicks with a woman?
Shut up, Mom!
How about taking me on, or is that too frightening for you?
You lonely, Mom? You want him?
The thing was, when we'd recorded it, we used to turn the lights off in the control room and just lie down on the floor and play it to ourselves. But not one of us said, oh, this could be a hit. It was only when we took it out of the studio, I played it to our friends and family and the record company there. Everyone said, this could be a single, it would be a big hit.
It was just so wonderful to be involved with that track. And it's been the best track that I have ever had the pleasure of being involved with, really. It was just, you know, it was just something, you know, you look up to the gods and say thank you when something like that comes in front of the speakers.
Fabulous song. I still love hearing it now. I don't think you ever get fed up with it, actually. It just stops you in your tracks, really. And no one would think that you'd still be hearing it all those years later. I'm not in
love. First time I ever heard I'm Not in Love, I thought it was absolutely brilliant. I thought I'd never heard anything like that before. And when I really started producing records in 1975, but it took me till late 1979 to have a hit. And through those years, whenever we got really excited about something that we'd done, I always used to say, come on, we've got to put on I'm Not in Love and just remind ourselves, you know, cure our studio fever, because it was such a great sounding record. So if I call you, don't make a fuss,
don't tell your friends about the two of us. I remember when I'm Not in Love came out, and everyone was just in awe, because A, it was a great song, had a great melody, but the idea of the lyric was fabulous. This, he complains too much aspect of it. And then the sound, the multi-layered vocals were a real treat to the ear. It's quite ironic that it comes out close in time to Bohemian Rhapsody, because those two are really the great multi-track hits of, dare I say, all time.
Both bands were hugely fond of overdubs. Massed vocals, you know? I mean, we were studio bands, essentially. I mean, Queen were lucky enough to have Freddie as a frontman. We didn't really have a frontman as such. We weren't showmen at all. I always describe us as we sounded like 400 maniacs from Hollywood, but looked like four scruffy gits from Manchester. And maybe that's why it didn't quite work as well as it could have done.
Looking back on that era, bands like Queen and other sort of more literary kind of bands got more recognition or are remembered more because they were more flamboyant than 10cc. 10cc were always a... we were all about the music.
By then we were a living, breathing, touring brand with responsibilities and people working for us, and we were quite successful, doing well. And I remember very distinctly we had a kind of pre-production meeting about what How Dare You might be. And I found it quite a disturbing meeting because it was sort of, it wasn't like, well, let's try a bit of this and let's try a bit of that. It was, well, we need one of those and we need two of those. It was that attempt to quantify who and what we were that I found slightly troubling. It took the freedom away. It took the sense that you could just go in there and try things. The need to be fresh was ever so slightly tarnished in a way.
There had become a bit of a routine to things, but for me, it was the routine that I wanted, I'd always wanted, and I think it was the same for Eric, but for Kevin Lowell, it was different. I think it was important for them to have fun and for things to be spontaneous, which I understood, but How Dare You signposted a big change for 10cc, I think. I think the writing was on the wall. Or the songwriting was on the wall.
I'd written a song called Mandy Fly Me. And completed it again with Graham Goldman. We got our first hit from the record with that one. But I thought there was an underlying thing going on here that I hadn't noticed before.
Kevin and Lyle weren't that happy in that they weren't enjoying it as much. And it also coincided with them doing an album that featured their invention of the Gizmotron, which was an attachment that went onto the guitar.
That entire music comes from one guitar, multi-tracked and fitted with a device called a gizmo. The gizmo was devised by Lowell Cream and Kevin Godley of 10cc.
This is the actual prototype that I had on my guitar. It's not been used for 40 years. But the electric motor is here. It's now got a drive cable, a little cable, that makes this rotary cog here spin. And every time I press one of those buttons, or all of them, they come down and the little rotary plectrums will strike the string. So I put it on the guitar, and I could play like that. I could pick and hold one down and play, or I could hold a chord down. I had it going, and even pluck other top lines. And then I learned to play it.
You're hoping it'll retail at approximately somewhere between £50 and £100, maybe £70, £75.
The thing about Kevin and Lowell was, in addition to being able to write some weird songs, they were really into gadgets and gizmos and electronics, and really they were ahead of their time. I mean, I sort of feel if they'd started out now, they would be very much at the forefront of all the technology that goes with music today. They were always pioneers, not just in the songwriting, but in the way it was presented.
When Kevin and Lowell designed this gizmo, the natural thought was, oh, where does this lead to? And this project, which was called Consequences, did indeed have consequences.
Kevin Lowell, who were actually recording Consequences at the time while the other album hadn't been completed. So they drain themselves as well. If they do a lot of work on Consequences and then they go in the studio afterwards and listen to what Eric and Graham had to offer and maybe they weren't very kind about it or something, I could see there being terrific tensions in there.
We had a meeting after one of these Buddy Holly days that Paul McCartney used to have. We're all there with Gardner, Clapton, Elton, Queen, oh, everybody in the music business there. After it, we started talking about the future of 10cc, and I played them The Things We Do For Love. And Kevin said, I don't like that. He said, in fact, it's crap.
He's like, what? This is bland, boring. I don't want to do this.
On reflection, was it great? Nothing wrong with that song at all. But to us then, me and Kev had been spent the previous 4 or 5 months grinding out this side one of Consequences. And the nature of the music that we were making was so far removed from the 10cc music. And we became consumed with it. And Things We Do For Love just seemed like another I'm not in love type of thing, which is all very well, but we didn't want to do that.
And they said that they didn't want to continue to do it anymore. They wanted to pursue their own careers, I guess, and try and do something with the gizmo. Part of me had tremendous admiration for them for doing it, and another part of me just thought they were completely mad.
I was trying desperately to keep them together. I really was. And even with hindsight, probably they would have been better off being kept together. But in those days, bands had to deliver on a budget, on a time scale. So although, like 20 years later, it would be nothing for a member of any band to say, look, I'm taking a year off, I'm going to do my own album, and I'm coming back later. And it's sad, because together they were a power.
I think at the end of the day, there's a natural lifespan of a band. It's been like the Spinal Tap film. You know, something else is going to happen within the band that will trip you up a bit. And initially, you can take it and say, all right, let's just carry on with it. But in the back of your mind, you're thinking, what's going on? Why? Why is this not working the way it did?
If I had my time over again, I suppose, within the band, I probably did too much talking and not enough strangling. Which would probably clear the air quicker. But, you know, you have other ambitions that don't necessarily have to be realised within that particular situation. And we kind of wanted to take 6 months off and do this experiment. But because we were forced into a corner and forced to leave because of it, we turned it into this gigantic Heaven's Gate style project. But that wouldn't have happened if we'd have been given the room to maneuver. So in a sense, it was a shame.
I regret the upset that it caused, hugely. Because it was like a divorce, you know, it was like a big divorce. It was caused terrible eruptions, you know, socially and all the rest of it. Because my wife, Ange, and Gloria, Eric's wife, are sisters. So it caused a terrible kind of rift in the family. But we couldn't stop ourselves from moving on.
It was a real shame, and something I'm still upset about to this day, because I think we could have done major things. Even though Eric and I carried on and did very well, it was different. It was different. I think the idea was that we'd go in the studio, there was just myself, Eric and Paul Burgess on the drums, and we'd just go in with the same attitude and just write some songs, see what happens.
Without Kevin Lowell there, I suddenly felt it was easier, a lot easier. And I worked so hard on that album. Obviously, I had something to prove, mainly to myself, that I could do it. But it had The Things We Do For Love, and that was such a massive hit. It sold more in the States than I'm Not in Love. So we were pleased, very, very pleased. You lay your bets and then you pay the price. The things we do for love, the things we do for love. Like walking in the rain and the snow when there's nowhere to go. When you're feeling like a part of you is dying. I'm very proud of the album. I think the album's great. I think we came up with some really interesting stuff. I can sense slightly we're trying to be Kevin Lowell at some point, but even so, I thought it was very good, and it was quite a well-received album. Things We Do For Love became a massive hit in America, and Good Morning Judge was a hit as well. Well, good morning, Judge, how are you today? I'm in trouble, please put me away. I pray the day took a shine of me. I couldn't stop, so let it be. They did great things, Graham and Eric, and with all the tracks, I'm quite happy to put Dreadlock Holiday up there, which they did, which is magic. I say I don't like cricket. Oh no, I love it. I don't like cricket. No, no, I love it. Dreadlock Holiday is a great story, based, I gather, on a true incident.
And I remember the first time I heard it, I remember thinking, I don't like cricket. And you think, oh, it's rather savage. And then immediately, I love it, you know. It's got everything. It's got a great rhythm. It's funny. It's witty. It's got an irresistible beat, but it's still sophisticated. I say, don't like Jamaica.
There were a few things that changed everything. Eric had an accident which put him out of commission for over a year. And in that time, I started working on other projects. The punk era had kind of happened. The landscape had changed. And when we came back, it wasn't the same.
Things were not really going very well between me and Goldman by then. We were really not writing stuff that was good enough for 10cc. I mean, there were divorces going on. I was very sorry the songs that were coming into the studio were so depressing. It was like, I can't get into these songs and they're boring.
We tried a few things to try and inject that magic back into us, into what we were doing, because we knew there was something wrong. But eventually, Eric and I called it a day in the very early 80s.
Keep pushing and keep trying and see what you can make unique.
For Cry, they were right out there in front of Michael Jackson, where the face morphs from one face into another face. Really genius, and they did it the hard way, frame by frame. And by the time Michael Jackson came on, did the same thing, you could all do it in a computer, easy peasy.
We got a few casting books and picked a bunch of faces. They sat in a chair with their head resting against a very small frying pan attached to the back of the chair, which held their head in place. And we shot each one of them doing the entire song. We asked everyone to learn it. And then we hit the edit suite. And that's where the magic happened.
The fact that Goldie and Cream turned out to have great control and mastery of visuals as well as audio, and all these gadgets and things they came up with, it is quite extraordinary. Run away. What I want to say is, you're a part of me. Let me be a part of you. I saw you so pretty. Your face lit up the sail. The two worlds came together. The memory stays forevermore. People say that I'm crazy. People call me a fool. They got no business to.
got no reason at all. I'll take a chance with you, baby. It doesn't matter at all.
It doesn't matter at all.
It doesn't matter at all.
So take a moment to wonder why the world keeps turning.
We made videos together, but we were really good friends. And whenever they would be in a city where I'd be, that's who we'd hang out with. Because they were, as chuckle buddies, nobody better. For sitting around of an evening, just laughing and laughing and doing outrageous stuff. Or if they're recording, making a film somewhere in the, you know, in the editing booth, that's the place to go hang. I think their knowledge and understanding, deep understanding of music, was what made them able to, the images dance with the music so effectively. I'll just go out on a limb and say that Kevin and Lowell created the modern video as we know it today, where they would do cool things instead of just the band, and that's what you get, flouncing around somewhere.
Sitting alone in the dark. Hey, hey, hey. Ooh, feeling it close to me. We're in a dream, but the hands on the clock seem to know. Tell me it's time to go.
And as a band, 10cc branched out into lots of different areas. They have influence beyond the obvious influence of fantastic songs and hit records.
If you look through their whole careers, not just while they were part of a group, I mean, you realize that they really are working in several different fields related to music, and they were working in music in different ways, but that's because that's what they loved.
The way I think of it was that I was the luckiest guy in the world to have, A, met up with Kev and do all those years of writing and art nonsense before I even met up with Eric and Graham, had 10cc. And then together, we had all that together, we did all that. And I loved every minute of it. I was given the opportunity to be as nuts as I wanted. And these other people helped make it into things which were sold. And we never went into it for fame or money. We went into it to enjoy ourselves. And not only did we enjoy ourselves, but we made a really marvellous living in the end.
10cc for me was an affirmation that what I was thinking and the ideas I was coming up with could in fact be liked by other people outside the confines of my head. I wasn't mad. I wasn't insane. And I have huge fond memories of those 4 years. A major, major step up creatively for me, and I'm sure for everybody involved in their own way.
I think the influence of 10cc is still being felt with certain bands. I know that because they say so. I'm very proud of what we did. I'm sorry that we didn't carry on, the four of us. But having said all that, we had a fantastic run, and it was one of the greatest musical periods of my life.
It wouldn't have happened if either one of us had not been there. It needed that collaboration and confliction between each other to make it work, and that we believed in each other and allowed it to happen and experimented just to see if it would work. Just to see if it would work. You know, what would it be like if?
Far away, but they still gonna play guitar.
old wild.